Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning. Our first agenda item is our fifth evidence session on the Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill. We have two witness panels this morning. For our first panel, we are privileged to welcome Senators of the College of Justice. The Right Honourable Lady Dorrian is the Lord Justice Clerk, the second most senior judge in Scotland. She was appointed a temporary judge in 2002 and became a judge in the Supreme Courts in 2005. She was appointed Lord Justice Clerk in 2016 and sits in the inner house of the Court of Session and is the President of the Second Division of the Inner House. Welcome. The Honourable Lord Ericht was appointed as a judge to the Supreme Courts in 2016. He sits in the outer house of the Court of Session and also presides over trials in the High Court of Judiciary. He is He is also chair of the UK Competition Appeals Tribunal. We are very grateful to both of you for giving up your time to speak to us today. We're very aware of the concerns that have been expressed by the senior judiciary with regards to the bill, both in response to our call for views and in correspondence with the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. And we will look to explore those in depth during this session. We also noted the DPLR Committee's report published last Thursday and have written to the Minister for Victims and Community Safety to seek more detail from her on what impact any potential changes to the bill might have and whether they will alleviate and address concerns that have been expressed. We are also expecting Oliver Mundell from the DPLR committee to attend as soon as his committee has concluded its business this morning. So, I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I invite Lady Dorrian to provide an opening statement on behalf of the Senators of the College of Justice before we move to questions.
Thank you very much, Convener. The Lord President is grateful to the committee for accepting his offer that Lord Ericht and I could attend today to indicate the grave concerns that we have with aspects of this bill. Members of the judiciary rarely attend Parliament to comment on proposed legislation, and the fact that we are doing so merely underlines the extent of our concerns. As you know, our principal concerns relate to the removal of the Lord President and the Court of Session as the ultimate regulators of the profession and the constitutional threats to the independence of the judiciary and of the legal profession contained in some of the provisions. Whilst the SLCC, the Law Society, faculty and others handle complaints, the profession is ultimately regulated by the Lord President, who has responsibility for the education, training and admission of all regulated lawyers, as well as for the disciplinary processes which apply to them. Independent by the Lord, regulation by the Lord President, independent from government, independent from Parliament, independent from the lawyers he regulates, ensures compliance with the separation of powers and the rule of law central to our democracy, and has evolved over hundreds of years to guarantee that it does so. Under the bill, Scottish ministers would be given direct control to change the professional obligations of lawyers, to reassign regulatory categories, to review the performance of or impose sanctions on the regulator, directly exercise power to regulate the profession, and even set up an entirely new regulator. These provisions clearly transgress against adherence to the rule of law, as do provisions requiring the Lord President to act jointly with Scottish ministers. It's equally unacceptable to remove the Court of Session's appellate jurisdiction designed to prevent the SLCC from acting unlawfully to the detriment of consumers and others. We agree, Madam Convener, that robust regulation is required and that regulatory bodies need to make continuous improvements in how complaints are handled in the interests of consumers. All that can be achieved without removing the role of the Lord President or introducing a role for government. The fundamental problem with the bill, as with the Roberton recommendations before it, are A, the mistaken premise that the legal profession regulates itself when there is an independent regulator in the Lord President, and B, a failure to recognise the importance of the independence of the profession as a fundamental aspect of the rule of law. The senior judiciary voiced strong objections to the Roberton recommendations on grounds which echo directly our concerns with the present bill, namely that the proposals are constitutionally inept. We are here to answer questions that the panel may have, the committee may have, and we're very happy to do so.
Thank you very much. I would like to now move on to questions. I'm going to kick us off and then my colleagues will come in. So you mentioned, Lady Dorrian, the role of the Lord President, and I just want to sort of give you an opportunity to unpick that a little bit. If possible, if you could give some practical examples of the role of the President as it is at the moment and the implications within the bill of what the Lord President would or would not be able to do?
Well, I can give you an overview immediately of what the Lord President does at the moment. He has overall responsibility as the head of the Court of Session for the regulation of the profession. He has responsibility for the criteria for admission or for removal or from office of an advocate, for regulating professional practice, conduct and discipline. His powers to regulate professional practice, conduct and discipline would all be adversely affected by the provisions of this Act. Whilst the faculty exercises functions which include handling disciplinary matters and complaints, that's under a delegated power from the court, where the Lord President retains overall responsibility. So the faculty's disciplinary rules must be approved by the Lord President and they can't be revoked or amended without his agreement. They're currently in the process being amended at the moment and he has written to them explaining certain changes that he requires them to make, including improvements to the time scales within which complaints are dealt with. Similarly, with the Law Society, the Society can only make rules regarding training, education, rights of audience, whether relating to training, professional practice, conduct, discipline, accounting, professional indemnity, or whatever. They can only make those rules if the Lord President approves. The Disciplinary Tribunal must get the Lord President's approval of any rules relating to its procedure and complaints and appeals. And he also appoints lay solicitors and members of the tribunal and has an important role in termination of appointments. As to the SLCC must consult the Lord President before making or amending rules about its practice and procedure or changes to those rules. The ministers must consult with the Lord President before appointing members of the SLCC. The chair of the SLCC may not remove a member from office without the agreement of the Lord President, and the Lord President can remove the chair from office if satisfied on the basis of rules set out in practice that it's appropriate to do so. So at every aspect of regulation, the Lord President is at the top and everything requires his say-so. The fundamental changes that this bill would have would be to remove the Lord President from that power of control as an independent regulator, independent of government, require him to act in certain circumstances along with government, which is constitutionally inept, as I'm sure you appreciate, and substitute his role in other regards for action by government or others. I think Lord Eriot has... We have already, I think, indicated these maps. And maybe I can hand over to Lord Eriot to go through them with you because it might help illustrate the point that we've been trying to make, if you could look at those.
Lord Eriot, please.
Certainly. The first one I'd like you to look at is the current regulatory framework. And you'll see in that the system is we have the Lord President at the top as the ultimate regulator of the legal profession. And underneath the Lord President as ultimate regulator, we have the professional bodies. So the system we have at the moment is the Lord President as regulator with limited self-regulation by the professional bodies. And the professional bodies have to get the consent of the Lord President. In fact, he makes the kind of rules that that Lady Dorian has mentioned. And the Court of Session Lord President's role as a regulator is bigger than that. The Court of Session can take direct control of a solicitor's firm through a system called appointing a judicial factor to take control of the company, and also can directly remove and suspend advocates. The advocates are there just as a delegated power of the Court of Session. So anything the Faculty of Advocates do is exercising a delegated power. The Faculty of Advocates has no independent right to regulate any advocates. So that's the overview as it is. I think the next one I think it might be helpful to look at is the model proposed by the Robertson Report. And we've replicated the SPICE briefing on this. And you'll see that this completely transforms the current system. So instead of the Lord President, the ultimate regulator, being at the top, the Scottish Parliament is at the top. Now, in terms of separation of powers, that's a major change. You're moving control of the profession from the judiciary to the Scottish Parliament. And that's quite deliberate. It's part of the whole scheme of Robertson. If you look at the first recommendation is that the new independent regulator is to be accountable to Parliament. So the Court of Session kind of falls off the edge in this plan. It doesn't have any place in the hierarchy. So what you have under Robertson is you continue to have a independent regulator, but instead of the independent regulator being the Lord President, the independent regulator is a new body answerable to the Scottish Parliament. Now, the next one I'd ask you to look at is the regulatory framework proposed by the Bill. And you'll see this immensely complicates the situation. In terms of constitutional theory, we now have a complete mishmash of the three branches of government. The Law Society Category 1 regulators report to the Scottish Parliament, and the Lord President and the Court of Session exercise various differing powers. Sometimes they can achieve the same thing by using different powers over the different bodies. And what you then have is the professional bodies, they split their functions. So they have a representative function and they have a separate regulatory committee. So that's where you get the split of the functions. Now, if you could then look at diagram, it's called diagram C. I'm sorry, the numbers and the letters don't really make much sense. But the next one to look at is the regulatory framework if the Scottish Government were to amend the bill to transfer ministerial powers to the Lord President. And on that analysis, the Lord President retains its place as the ultimate regulator of the legal profession. But still underneath that, the existing limited self-regulation of the professional bodies is, in a sense, limited even further because they are split into a representative part and a regulatory part. And the final thing, I think I might just mention it just now, if the convener would find it helpful, is just to have a look at the English position, because I think that's quite useful by way of background to understand what happens in England. Now, of course, as far as lawyers are concerned, we tend to look on England as a completely foreign country, because it does have its own separate legal system, which has been preserved since 1707. So what do we have in England? Well, you've got to understand the historical position in England has always been very different from Scotland. In England, you had self-regulation of lawyers through professional bodies. In Scotland, you've never had that. Ever since the Court of Session was created back in 1532, the Court of Session has been the ultimate regulator. So the reforms which were brought in England in 2007 were to address the position whereby the professions were self-regulating. And if you look at the oversight map which we've taken from the Legal Services Board, you will see that they have got to a position which is quite similar to Scotland. On the top, you have the Legal Services Board, which is an independent regulator. So in the Scottish system, that is the place where the Lord President sits as independent regulator. And under that, you have the professional bodies, the Law Society, Bar Council, etc. And the Law Society and Bar Council are then split into a separate representative and regulatory part. So where you end up here in England is you have, as in Scotland, an independent regulator sitting underneath that, the professional bodies with limited self-regulation split into a representative and regulatory part. The only thing I'd mention about this is that in terms of this diagram, it doesn't show where things go upward from the Legal Services Board, but I think that's quite important to know as well, because constitutionally, England is really in a very, very different position from Scotland. So if you look upwards from the Legal Services Board, the Legal Services Board reports to the Lord Chancellor. And we don't have anything in Scotland at all similar to the Lord Chancellor. Traditionally, the Lord Chancellor's head of the judiciary. So if you wanted to plot his traditional role, it's the equivalent of the Lord President. Mm. But in 2007, there was a big reform, and the judicial functions were mostly removed, but the Lord Chancellor retained some judicial functions, and one judicial function he retained was that the Legal Services Board reports to him. And I think that's quite significant, because it's not reporting to him as a cabinet minister or a member of parliament. It's reporting to him in what is the remnants of his role as head of the judiciary. So I hope that helps to explain. I'm happy to elucidate in more detail, I think.
Thank you very much for that. The diagrams were exceptionally helpful, and I don't say that just as a teacher who loves diagrams, but they do illustrate things. Can I just come back to just ask for points of clarification? So
yes.
Under the current regulatory framework, it says that Scottish ministers have a duty to consult the Lord President. What does that actually involve? So is that like a legal duty to consult on, for example, what? And how do you know that they have consulted? Does that transfer into decisions? I'm just interested in what power they have at the moment.
The power, they must consult before making rules,
uh-huh.
And they must consult in relation to changes to the rules for practice or procedure, and they must consult before appointing members to the SLCC. So that is usually done on a formal consultation basis,
okay.
Where the rules would be proposed, the Lord President would consider them, would indicate whether he deems them acceptable or not, or if it's a question of changing the rules, whether those changes are acceptable or not. I imagine there may sometimes be a dialogue in order to achieve something that is acceptable to the Lord President. I don't have any personal experience of that. And equally, there would be a formal consultation in relation to the appointment of members of the SLCC.
Okay, thank you. So we're in that situation at the moment. Obviously, the Minister has indicated that there will be amendments that are coming that should allay some of the concerns that have been quite robustly made. But we are in that situation where we don't know what those are.
Sure.
So I suppose in that wiggle room space, would either of you like to maybe give me an indication of what those amendments could be that could address your concerns?
Well, much as I would like to draft the legislation, I don't really think we can. I mean, it's good, I think, that the Scottish ministers have recognised that it's important to amend the bill to address some of our concerns. We have had engagement to a certain degree about what the main issues are, as I outlined in my introduction. But we don't have, as you yourself have pointed out, Madam Convener, any idea of what those will look like. And as ever with these things, the devil is in the detail. And whether amendments that are to be proposed, and we don't know what they are yet, whether they will address our concerns adequately or not, remains to be seen. It's really not possible to discuss it in a vacuum, because you need to know what the proposals are. So, for example, simply transferring functions from the proposal that they go to the Scottish ministers, simply transferring those to the Lord President is unlikely to be sufficient, because it doesn't address some of the underlying issues that are there. And it doesn't address, so for example, simply transferring some of those functions to the Lord President. So just to take an example, the power to create a new regulator. You can't just transfer that to the Lord President and say, that's fine, that means everything's okay. How would the Lord President go about doing that? How would the system enabling him to do that look like? How would it work? That in itself risks politicising the role of the Lord President. Mm. So the extent to which the amendments will address concerns really cannot be determined in advance of seeing the amendments. I think it's as simple as that.
Okay, thank you. A final one for me, and then I'm going to bring Karen in on this theme as well. Sort of just to finish off, so the views of consumers, obviously, just interested in how the Lord President takes that into account when he is carrying out his regulatory functions. For example, are there any formal processes to ensure that consumer views are considered in addition to the views of the legal profession?
Well, the Lord President does consider that the interests of consumers are vital, and that's one of the reasons why, as I say, he wrote to the faculty to raise with them the issue of timescales and the difficulties that have been raised in relation to some recent examples in connection with that for the faculty. I think that Lord Eric perhaps will be able to deal with the question about consumers more adequately.
Although the Lord President's door would no doubt be open if consumer groups wanted to meet him, the formal structures are different, because the formal structures are consumer groups engage with the at the professional body level or on the consumer panel of the of the Scottish Legal Complaints Committee. Now, the current regulatory framework, of course, we are not saying that it's ideal. There are many ways in which it could be improved, and it may be that a process for more consumer involvement would improve it. But I think our point here and today for the committee is that you don't need to remove the powers from the Lord President to make them better. You could strengthen the Lord President's powers in relation to consumers without removing his powers to regulate. So, and we're always looking to improve and to do things better. And one of the key issues that consumers are concerned with, and this comes back to the Competition and Markets Authority's view on things. One of the main things they're concerned with from the CMA point of view is price transparency and the extent to which consumers can shop around for prices. Well, you don't need to remove the President's regulatory powers to solve that. It can all be done within the same structure or by improvements to the structure.
Okay.
Can I something there that... save in relation to the Faculty of Advocates, which is in a separate position. So far as matters concerning the SLCC, for example, and the Law Society, by and large, dealing with regulatory matters, the Lord President can only operate within the framework which has been given to him by Parliament. And the bill could, this bill could have sought to strengthen his powers of regulation, particularly in the interests of consumers, but instead the opportunity to do that wasn't taken in favour of introducing governmental involvement. Now, I can give one small example of a situation which arose in relation to the SLCC and the Law Society. I don't want to go into great detail about this, but the SLCC raised with the Lord President an issue that they were complaining that a number of lawyers were not responding to them or not providing them with necessary material. The Law Society disputed the figures that were being suggested as to this by the Commission, and the Lord President was... That's a factual issue. It must be possible to determine, as a matter of fact, how many there are. The Lord President suggested that it would be useful if the two would work together in the public interest and in the interest of consumers in order to present him with a joint factual basis on which he could then address the extent of the problem, what the problem was, how it could be resolved. That fell on deaf ears, and let's just put it that way. It fell on deaf ears, and he does not have the power to make any kind of direction in that regard. There are a number of areas in which the bill could have strengthened the Lord President's powers, but it didn't do so.
OK, thank you. Cadden Adam, please.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel.
Yes.
And I appreciate your answer to the question earlier from the Convener in regards to you can't really speculate on amendments, for example. But I was just wondering, if I can word it like this, if there are any updates on discussions between the Lord President and the Scottish Government in terms of any areas which may be... easier to transfer in an amendment to the Lord President from the Scottish Government as the bill proposes at the moment. For example, you said it would be tricky to set up an independent regulator. Are there any areas that would be possible that you could see? Any hints?
Well, I think that this, you know, we have to look at this as an overall scheme of regulation, and I don't think it's really easy to cherry-pick one bit and say, oh, well, that might work. Because, again, whether it might be possible to amend to address the concerns depends on precisely the wording of the amendment. And, frankly, we are in a very strange position because... we had no sight of the bill before it was published, and we are, like everyone else, reacting to the contents of it and trying to work backwards rather than work forwards. And so I'm sorry, I have to decline the invitation.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Megan, please.
Thank you, Convener. As it stands, the Parliament is scrutinising legislation the Scottish Government itself intends to amend, and that's been part of the discussion that we've had thus far. So we're looking at the bill at face value, but we know that there are significant and valid concerns that have already been raised, and we don't know if these amendments, you know, will make the bill more amenable to those in the legal profession. So I'm just wondering, I just want to throw this question out, but do you think there is a risk that the intended amendments, if they're not forthcoming as soon as possible, that this could lose confidence within the legal profession in terms of the principle and the direction of the bill? And given that we might have to invite witnesses back to re-scrutinise the amendments once we have sight of them, I mean, do you think that this could set back the intended bill's principle itself?
Well, all I would say is that obviously the sooner one can see the amendments that are being proposed and can understand what shape that gives the bill thereafter and what it would mean for the regulatory framework in the country, the easier it will be to address those issues, to address the concerns, and to try to find a way forward. But seeing sight of the amendments has really got to be the first stage.
Thank you.
Can I just add, through the convener here, that we're a long way away from that. Mm. We've had some high-level proposals from the Scottish Government as to how they may amend the bill, and there have been some conversations between officials, but we need a lot more information from the Scottish Government before we can consider whether whatever proposals they come up with are viable. And the essential thing will be to see the draft amendments, because it's only at that stage that we can focus on them.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to bring in Annie, please.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, panel. The bit I'm trying to get to grips with is the independent regulator. And in your call for, in our call for views, the argument you put forward was that the independent regulator proposed by the Roberton Review would threaten the independence of the legal profession and the rule of law, as well as a Lord Advocate, the Lord President. So I was wondering whether you could expand a bit more on that for us, please.
Well, the fundamental weakness of the Roberton proposals, rather like the present legislation, are that they rested on the false premise that the legal profession regulates itself.
Mm-hmm.
There was a complete failure to understand the role of the Lord President as the independent regulator. The Senators of College of Justice didn't even feature on the list of consultees for Roberton. That in itself, I think, is an indication of the extent to which there was a complete failure to understand the role of the Lord President and the Court of Session in the regulation of the profession. The other failure was in not appreciating the extent to which the proposals impinged on the rule of law by importing a degree of political control over the profession, creating the same risks as the current legislation. So on the map that we saw, putting the Scottish Parliament at the head of this and making the regulator of the profession accountable to the Scottish Parliament clearly impinges on the independence of the legal profession. Mm-hmm. And the independence of the legal profession is an essential aspect of independence of the judiciary. One, you can't have one without the other. And making the profession accountable in that way just transgresses against the separation of powers. It's really as simple as that. It fails to recognise that the legal profession must be independent from government and from Parliament. There's just a lack of understanding of fundamental democratic principles. You know, it's particularly important to recognise that independence is not something that's created for the benefit of lawyers. It's not there for their to shield them or to make them unaccountable. It's designed to benefit the individual consumer, to make sure that someone who may end up having to sue the government may be sure of obtaining a lawyer who'll be absolutely fearless in the presentation of their case and entirely independent of any government influence. And it's of particular importance if you think that between April 2016 and November 2023, there have been 4,946 civil cases before the courts involving the government. Nearly 5,000 cases. And, of course, some of those are high-level litigations. There have been two litigations about the representation of public boards, one in relation to the census, a Section 35 challenge, which is still undergoing at the moment, a reference to the Supreme Court and the independence referendum, litigation about the UNCRC, the named person system, loads of others. These are really high-level, important matters, and it's essential that individuals who want to challenge the government can do so through an independent lawyer of their own choosing who is not going to be subject to any kind of government influence or risk of discipline.
Thank you very much for that. And, Convener, I think my other question was answered earlier by Lord Ettrick, so thank you.
All right, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think it was just... the other bit was about the Legal Services Board. I think it was Lord Eric that mentioned that earlier about England and Wales. And it was a very different system. Thank you for explaining that. I'm just sort of like looking here at sort of like the evidence from Chris Kenny, that there was no evidence that the independent regulation has damaged the independence of the legal profession in England and Wales. What's your view on that?
I think we're slightly at cross purposes on that, because what we say is we already have independent regulation, okay, and that's been taken away.
Right.
I think he's coming at it from a separate angle, which is that you could have an independent regulator who wasn't the Lord President.
Mm.
And we would say about that, well, first of all, you have to justify removing and completely changing the system. And secondly, in respect of that, we'd have to say, well, maybe you could do it that way, but it would have to come under the control of the Lord President and not under the control of Parliament or elsewhere. So I think we're talking about two different things, not so much an independent regulator, but about who is the person that regulates. And we're not sitting here with a blank piece of paper. We have to address ourselves to what's in the bill and to what's in the Robertson report. If you set millions of permutations you could have to work out a legal system, and one of them might include a kind of legal services type board under the authority of the Lord President. That's not been suggested by anyone, so we don't want to get into speculation about that.
Fair enough. Thank you very much. I'd like to bring in my colleague Paul, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to your Lordships.
Good morning.
I think the Convener kind of began in the area I'm interested in. Last week, I had an exchange with Mr Dunlop on behalf of the faculty around this issue about an independent regulator. And Mr Dunlop's contention, I think, was that it's an academic discussion in some ways, given that it's not in the bill. You know, there's not in the scope of the bill an independent regulator. I think the challenge for this committee will be taking a view more broadly on whether that would be something that, you know, the government may wish to consider at some point in the future in terms of Robertson. So I just wonder if we can expand just on the point that Lord Eric made there around your concerns about independent regulation. And I know we've heard quite a bit of this already, but, you know, any future move towards what was in Robertson?
We have no concerns with independent regulation. And I think we need to be absolutely clear about this. We have no concerns with independent regulation because we have independent regulation. We have independent regulation in the form of the Lord President. Now, if there's a wish to strengthen the Lord President's powers in that regard, well and good. But that's not what's been done. And we have no difficulty whatsoever with independent regulation. As Lord Eric says, the question is, who does it? And the problem with Robertson is you have responsibility of the regulator to the Scottish Parliament. And that is just constitutionally inept. And it's an impossible system. And the question of whether further down the line the independent regulation by the Lord President is changed in some way to feature an independent board answerable to the Lord President, that's an entirely different landscape that we're not being asked to look at here. And as with the question of amendments, you would need to look at what any scheme was before you could actually address whether it did offend against constitutional principles or not. But the point would be, if you have independent regulation at the moment, what is the benefit of changing that to appoint another independent regulator when you could actually make improvements and strengthen the powers given to the current independent regulator?
I think we heard some of that last week, certainly as well, from the faculty and Law Society and others. I mean, do you think there is a real problem of perception here, of people thinking that if something is a body, if you like, that is completely, you know, separate and kind of lay people's views, that that is independent regulation rather than actually the Lord President being an independent regulator as it stands.
I do think that there is an element there that people don't quite understand, that, that what we do have at the moment is independent regulation. It's a challenge, undoubtedly, to get over, to explain so that people fully understand that we have got a system which involves independent regulation at the moment. I think you have got a point there.
And I wonder if I might finally, just in terms of the known unknown, if you like, to borrow a phrase, around the amendments. I mean, the Lord President, I presume, has made certain views known about what those amendments might contain. Can I ask about what the engagement has been like with government thus far from the Lord President's point of view in that regard?
Well, we have had, as I say, high-level suggestions made to us. I think what happened was that we were presented with a paper. We felt we couldn't respond to that paper because it was lacking in detail. We had another paper submitted to us which had more detail, but all at a high level, all at a very high level, about what the options for amendment might be. So that's the level of it. It's not looking at actual detailed proposals for amendment or anything else. And insofar as we were able to, we responded to that in as positive a way as we could, in as helpful a way as we could. But as we have said repeatedly, and as I think everyone in this room appreciates, until you see the detail, you can't find the devil.
And sorry, Lord Eric, you had said, and correct me if I'm wrong, that we're some way off from that point of perhaps having substantive amendments. Do we have any sense of timescale from government about? Because I think we've been frustrated at trying to get that detail. So.
No, we don't. It's just as Lady Dorian has explained, we've given some high-level comments about some high-level options. That's where we're at.
Okay. I'm grateful to your lordships. Thank you, convener.
We have time, so I am happy to bring in Oliver Mundell from the DPLR committee this morning for a question, please, Oliver.
Morning, and thank you for making the time in your schedule to come to the Parliament. I'm particularly concerned around a number of the delegated powers in the bill, particularly in relation to Section 5 on the regulatory objectives and principles, and the Lord President obviously wrote himself to the convener of the DPLR committee, setting out some concerns. And in that, he says that his consent would, or withholding consent would not be a veto, and flags up the risk of judicial review. And I just wondered if you're able to kind of elaborate on how that might come about.
Well, I agree with that entirely. I mean, I think issue in relation to Section 5, we simply think it's unacceptable to have that delegated power to amend or remove the regulatory objectives and professional principles, and I've yet to see any justification for it. I think that's the problem with a number of the delegated powers that are here, that there is really very little by the way of justification for them when you look at the current system and you look at what is the mischief that this is intended to address. It's really rather difficult. I think that I would entirely agree with the contents of the Lord President's letter to the convener of that committee of the 17th of November.
Because the Minister who's taking forward the bill wrote to the committee also on the 16th of November, and in relation to Section 5 and some other sections, there was a suggestion that it might be possible to narrow the scope of these changes so that they're only possible at the recommendation of certain bodies. And I wondered, you know, in terms of getting into more specific detail on what amendments might look like, we heard from the Faculty of Advocates and the Law Society that there was no amendments in relation to those in relation to Section 5 that would make it acceptable. And I just wondered if there was kind of further amendments to it that wouldn't alleviate your concerns.
I think it's unlikely because the issue with something like Section 5 is there's no explanation as to why it's needed, and should a situation arise, Mr. Mundell, where it was necessary to consider changing, amending or removing regulatory objectives or professional principles, that's a matter of the utmost importance. And the idea that it should in any circumstances be left to a delegated power seems to me to be highly unsatisfactory. I don't know whether Lord Eric has anything to add.
You can see that when you look at the examples of it, and I don't have the Act in front of me, but for example, there's a regulatory objective that lawyers must act independently and in the best interests of your client. As the bill actually stands, the government could abolish that. Now, that is so absolutely significant that if it were to be abolished, then that should have a proper parliamentary act to deal with that.
So you think that Section 5, for example, should only be able to be changed by primary legislation?
Yes.
OK, thank you.
Can I just add, there's a kind of knock-on to that, because there's also a general, I think it's Section 90 or something, a general clause allowing amendments to the bill, and that may have to be looked at as well to check that it isn't used as a back door to do the Section 75 things.
Thank you. I'd like to bring Maggie in, please.
Thank you. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning and articulating so clearly the concerns that you've outlined. I'm interested in... I'm wondering if you could just unpick for us a little bit more around your concerns with the proposal to abolish the right of appeal to the Court of Session and what that would do, or what you perceive it would do in terms of delays, in terms of consumer experience, I suppose, as well as the broader legal questions at stake.
Yeah, of course. Right. Well, there is the constitutional point, which is that the right of appeal to the Court of Session is part of the regulation of the profession. It's part of the exercise of regulatory functions by the court. It's important that there should be a right of appeal to the inner house of the Court of Session and not to any other court, not to a lower court which does not play a part in that regulatory function. It's the Court of Session which does. Excuse me. It would also, I think, a right of appeal to another, a lower court, or worse still, the abolition of a right of appeal, diminishes the importance of the issues to the consumer, which are considerable. And it wouldn't entirely prevent cases being brought to the Court of Session, because judicial review would still be available. But that, as I'm sure you're aware, is not a complete jurisdiction. And it would be far from satisfactory looking at the history of appeals to the inner house. And importantly, it would not enable any systemic failures in the disciplinary process to be identified, which an appeal process which looks at the facts as well as looking at the facts found as well as the decision made can do. And it would be gravely mistaken to think that there would be any financial saving by removing the right of appeal, or that there would be a saving in time. Perhaps I could give you some figures. We have a note of the number of appeals to date. So from 2020, and I'm only using that figure because from that date we have them specifically as appeals direct to the Inner House as opposed to potential other cases involving the SLCC. So using those figures, there have been 12 appeals since 2020. Of those, two are still alive. 10 of them have been resolved. Of those 10, 4 were disposed of by agreement. In other words, they were settled between the SLCC and the individual. 6 of them were successful. In 6 of them, the court held that the SLCC had acted unlawfully. Of the 10 cases that went to the inner house, Six of them were appeals at the instance of the lawyer, but four of them were appeals at the instance of the consumer. So almost half of them are appeals at the instance of the consumer seeking to vindicate their rights. The average period of time that these appeals took from start to finish was 34 weeks. Excuse me. Now, that's because it's a one-step process, straightforward, straight to the inner house of the Court of Session. If you change that by what is proposed in the bill, you change a one-step process to potentially four-step process. The first step is the internal review, the marking of the own homework. The second one is the bringing of a judicial review to the outer house of the Court of Session. As is, could be predicted, I think, a fair number of those would be appealed. That would be stage three, an appeal to the inner house. And it's not inconceivable, in a very important case, that there could be an appeal to the UK Supreme Court from that, which has never actually had a jurisdiction in this field at all hitherto. And as to the costs, I can give you some figures for that too. Using the Court of Session Fees Order of 2022 as a guide, and I'm talking averages here, obviously this isn't doesn't apply to every single case, it's the average. The average fees payable to the court for bringing an appeal to the inner house is around £947. These are exclusive of what you pay for your lawyer on top of that. There's the court fees. The fees for bringing a judicial review to the outer house on average range from £1,142 to £1,455. It may be expected, as I say, that a number of these cases brought as judicial review would then be appealed, so you would add the £947 on top of that. So the cost would, it would definitely be more. I find it impossible to accept the suggestion that it would be cheaper to abolish the direct right of appeal to the inner house. And of course, your 34 weeks would go off and up the Cowgate, because the length of time that it would take to present a judicial review would be significantly longer. I think the average time for a decision on a judicial review is 17 months. Yeah. And then, of course, you might have an appeal to the inner house. So I fail to see the justification for removing the right of appeal for a consumer dissatisfied with the decision of the SLCC to the inner house to correct that decision in a simple, straightforward, relatively cost-effective process should be changed, because we've had 10 cases in the last 3.5 years.
I wonder if the volume of cases is an indication that maybe consumers don't feel confident enough to or able to use the direct route, and whether one of the issues that the proposals of having what might be intermediate routes or just might be lower level, if that makes sense, so maybe that doesn't seem as daunting to a consumer. Can you see that as being an argument?
I can see it being suggested, but I can't see it as being an accurate right. Situation. You know, in England they have a situation where a person can complain to the ombudsman, and the ombudsman can say, well, because the lawyers, and this has happened in a specific case, because the lawyer has agreed to abate the fees by 3/4, then we don't need to investigate it, and the individual is left with
nothing.
You know, and you know that's going to put people off.
Yeah. There are,
so I think. I don't really think that that's an answer. And the reality is that any appeal should be to the court that has the regulatory responsibility. An appeal to, say, the Sheriff Court or even the Sheriff Appeal Court wouldn't suffice, because they do not have that responsibility. And, you know, over the years, the court has had to correct a number of decisions of the SLCC where they have not complied with time limits, for example, where they've investigated matters they did not have authority to investigate, where they have miscategorised complaints. That's a quite a common issue about which consumers express concern, where they've sought to waive legal professional privilege when it wasn't permissible. These are matters of some considerable importance and they should be dealt with at the appropriate level.
Okay. Sorry, Lord Eric, did you want to come in on that too?
Certainly. I just wanted to add something about the cost, because I know that the SLCC are concerned about the costs involved and the costs of the profession. But you'll have seen from these statistics that the SLC lost every single case that went to hearing. And the reason why they have incurred a lot of legal fees is because when they've lost, they've had to pay their own legal fees and the other side. So you have to look carefully at the reason for this expense. It's because they have run cases which they've lost.
Okay. No, that's helpful. Another question, if I may, thinking about the different regulatory regimes and the proposal to split the regulators, and we heard last week from the Law Society that such a split is not appropriate. And I was just interested to know if you or the senators have a view on this, or whether you consider it to be, you know, the Law Society's decision, I suppose. Or
can I just clarify? You mean the split between the regulatory arm and the
the two different types of regulators.
Well, categories one and two. It's not something we have a strong view on. The only thing which we bring to the table on this is that the Faculty of Advocates is not an independent regulator. So it's a Category 2 regulator, but it's actually the Court of Session which has that power, just happens to have delegated to the faculty. But beyond that, we don't have anything to say about that.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there for now.
Thank you very much. Could I bring in Karen Adam, please?
Thank you, Convener. The Association of Construction Attorneys stated last week that becoming a new regulator under the existing rules, and I'll quote them, was challenging and at times traumatic, and that no reasons were given from the Lord President for decisions. So can I ask, do you think that rules in sections 25 to 37 of the bill on applications to become a new regulator need to be amended in some way to deal with this issue?
Well, I wonder how easy it should be to be able to become a new regulator. These are really important, serious powers. The court has to be satisfied that anybody being given these powers has the skill, the experience, the knowledge, operates within the correct ethical and professional way in order to be able to exercise such powers. I think it is probably only right that should be a relatively challenging process, because these are very important matters to preserve the standards for consumers, to make sure that those who enter this field know what they're doing, have got ethical responsibilities, can be trusted to act in the best interests of the consumers, are conscious of their obligations to the court, and are altogether suitable to be put into that role. I don't think it should be an easy process.
Yeah, it's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Are you satisfied? Brilliant. So we're nearing the end. Just to give an opportunity to any of my committee members, if they have anything that they wish to clarify, this is your moment while we have you. Maggie?
I suppose one possibly slightly cheeky question, if I may. In your earlier responses, Lady Dorian, you were very, very clear about the powers that need to reside in the person of the Lord President. What happens if that person goes rogue? Sorry.
Well, we don't legislate on the basis that we have to worry about people going rogue. There are provisions that if the Lord President becomes incapacitated in some way, then the Lord Justice Clerk becomes interim Lord President, as it were. So there are steps that can be taken to address that. I certainly think that we would notice if the Lord President went rogue.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, I think I get Maggie's point there, is that obviously sort of, you know, having that much of power and over legislature and everything else. But from a consumer's point of view, I suppose it's about transparency. That's the more serious point, is that anybody's decisions are transparent and open, and there are enough checks and balances within the system that transparency is provided for. That, I think, is the point that Maggie was trying to make.
But, I mean, the system is not incompatible with transparency. And as I've already said, there are the fact that there may be improvements that could be made does not mean that you have to throw out the baby with the bathwater, as they say. Mm-hmm. And the improvements can be made within the current system, and they already are being made.
I suppose there's that point, is who oversees the overseer? And I wonder if that was at the root of some of what the Robertson report was trying to get at. You've made the case very clearly that it's inappropriate, but I do wonder if that's... And we have Esther Robertson coming in later, so we can ask her.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, that concludes any questions that the panel have. And Lady Dorian or Lord Ericht, do you have any final points that you wish to make?
I don't think so. I think that covers everything. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you for hearing us.
And once again, can I thank you on behalf of the committee for giving up your time this morning. We do appreciate how busy you are, and it has certainly been valuable evidence this morning. I suspend the meeting briefly whilst we change witnesses. Thank you. Thank you, and we now move on to our second evidence panel for this morning. But before we start, could I ask at this point for any register of interests?
Thank you, Convener. Just to say that Esther Robertson and I worked together when I was Rector of Aberdeen University and she was Senior Governor, and we were also both on the Scottish Futures Forum together.
Thank you, Maggie. We'll put that on record. So, welcome to Esther Robertson, who was commissioned back in 2017 to chair the Independent Review of Legal Services in Scotland. Her report, Fit for the Future, Report of the Independent Review of Legal Services Regulation in Scotland, was published in October 2018. The report's main recommendation was that an independent body with a non-legal chair and a non-legal majority should be set up to regulate legal professionals, with the professional body only retaining their role as a representative of the profession. The new system would be financed by a levy on practitioners. So I welcome Esther Robertson to the meeting, and we are very grateful that you accepted our belated invitation to appear before us. And I would now like to invite you to make an opening statement before we move to questions.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener, and thank you for the invitation. It is a bit strange having already done a session in front of the Delegated Powers Committee, so you may already know some of what I'm about to say, but I will, for the record, briefly set the context. As you say, I was commissioned in 2017 and I spent 18 months on the review, which it's now more than 5 years since I published. So I would preface all my remarks by saying I am not as in command of some of the detail as I might have been 5 years ago, but I have gone back to the report to refresh my memory. I was disappointed, as you won't be surprised to know, that it's taken this long and that my principal recommendation wasn't accepted, and I'll come back to that. I am aware, not least of which because Jamie, who I worked with at the time, is sat behind me here, that civil servants have been working hard over that time to find a compromise between the two opposing positions. But of course, in my view, you can't compromise. Either you believe in independent regulation, as I do, or you don't, and there is no halfway house. My review took 18 months. I was supported with an expert panel, which included some very senior solicitors and others with regulatory experience. And over that time, supported by a small secretariat, we did a wide range of engagement with a wide range of stakeholders, both from the professions and from consumer bodies and with individual groups of lawyers. The idea was that one of my challenges was to balance the consumer and the professional interest. We also commissioned significant research, and I became more of an expert about regulation than I ever expected I might. My conclusion was then, and it still is, that regulation should be independent of those it regulates, a position supported by the CMA and by other consumer bodies, and by many senior members of the profession. In fact, one very senior member of a big supporter of the Law Society said to me early on, "I've heard you say about the perception of the public that the Law Society would always take the side of the lawyer, and I've realised that that perception alone is damaging to the profession, whether it's true or not." He said, "The thing that worries me most is that on reflection I realise that on the rare occasions when there is that conflict, it is actually the case that it does side with the profession, because in the end that is what it's there to represent." I don't believe the current model serves the profession or the public. And Lauren Crerar, when we launched the report, went on record as saying he was a keen supporter of a law society that represented him as an individual, his firm, his profession, and Scots law as a model for the rest of the world. But that he was not happy with that representative body and professional support body also being the body that would prosecute, and have come across that word a few times. And if you're a lawyer being prosecuted through the Law Society, where do you go for support? Because you can't go to your professional body. I do believe that the global direction of travel in regulation is towards independence. I've been surprised throughout my time to hear people confuse the architects, because of course the architects themselves now have a separate independent regulator called the Architects Registration Board, and they have their membership bodies, as do dentists, doctors, teachers and others. So the direction of travel across the professions is there. But in fact, in the legal profession, it's also the direction of travel. Ireland had already done so by the time I started my review, albeit it hadn't been terribly effective and the legislation was pretty muddled. Since then, Stephen Mason, who started his review quite late on during my time, I didn't think would come down to the conclusion of independent regulation, but he shared his report and he obviously did. And most recently, Ron Patterson, who'd been here for a visit, and his colleagues came to the same view in New Zealand. And it's interesting that in New Zealand, that review was actually commissioned by the Law Society, where they have both roles. Their only funding is for the regulatory role, so they are already preparing for what they will be as a membership body and how they will persuade the profession to fund them, because they've accepted that regulatory model. The bill definitely goes some way to address many of the problems that we identified, in particular around complaints, but I also think it causes others. And I suspect the one that you'll have heard most of is about the role it gives Scottish Government, because my review was very clear that independent regulation should not just be independent of those it regulates, but also of the government. And I think nowhere other than law is that more critical. So I gave Parliament a role, not that it has any control, but that it would appoint. And despite assurances the Law Society never quite got the message, Parliament would be required to appoint the chair, and it would require two-thirds majority to remove the chair, so it could never be government or party political decisions. In conclusion, I don't think that the current bill helps. I think it seems to have upset everybody, which sometimes you could say is a good sign, in that nobody is wholly happy. The thing that's come to me as I've been reflecting since I went back to my report was that when I was commissioned, I came up with a set of recommendations, but wasn't asked and hadn't given consideration at that time to how you would transition from the current model to a new model. And I think one of the solutions to the current dilemma is that you could move that transition to the front of the bill and could look at a way of creating something like a legal standards board in Scotland that would be a first step towards an independent regulator. And you could give them the powers that Scottish Government currently have in the bill that upsets everybody, I think, including the consumer bodies. That would create that independence from the profession. And given that I know you've had the senators this morning, would also give you an opportunity to codify the role of the Lord President. Because in my discussions with him, it was clear to me that the role of the Lord President is hugely wide, and that, yes, he is the overarching regulator. But my own view was the risk of him being a direct regulator is quite significant. A, it politicises him. And B, if I want to go to court as an individual that's not happy with the regulator, then if the Lord President is ultimately that regulator, I think that creates a real conflict. So I think there's an opportunity now to revisit, in light of the evidence I understand you've heard, that could take us a step closer to my recommendation, satisfy the needs of the consumer, perhaps the senators themselves. Obviously, I doubt the Law Society or the faculty would be happy, because it would be a step towards them losing part of their function. But I believe in the interests of the public and in the long-term interests of the profession, that would be the right thing to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Just to kick us off, before I bring in my committee members, obviously, well, I don't know whether you heard the previous evidence session as well, but also in written evidence, we've heard that your review was fundamentally flawed in its premise that the legal profession in Scotland regulates itself, and that has been totally refuted. So why do you think that it's had that response?
I don't think I can tell you why it's had it, but I do think there is a misunderstanding between the role of the Lord President as the independent regulator and the role of the professional bodies. So I don't think the premise is false. And again, if you come back to perception, the perception of the public will always be that the Law Society and the faculty will look after their own, if you like. So I think there is a debate to be had about the Lord President's role and the role of the judiciary, but I'm not persuaded that the two are irreconcilable in the way that I do think the profession's regulating themselves, which is what most of the work is done in the professional bodies, not by the Lord President. He has oversight and the final say, but that's a very different role in my view.
Mm-hmm. OK, thank you. It was just to get us going. I'd like to bring in Maggie, please.
Thanks, Kirkhope, and good morning, Esther. Thank you for joining us this morning. I suppose, actually, just following up from that last point, oversight and the final say as different to regulation. Could you just unpick what you mean by that a little bit more?
Well, I was always very clear that when you set up an independent body, that body would be required to work with the professions and with the Lord President. It would not be operating in a vacuum, and it wouldn't be looking to Parliament for guidance. So you would have, to backtrack, one of the arguments the Law Society made against the case was that at the moment a lot of their regulatory activity is supported by lawyers who give their time voluntarily. Mm-hmm. And my argument was that would not change. If you still have an independent regulator, I believe those lawyers would continue to contribute in the interests of their profession. And there would be legal members on the panel itself. And the Lord President would be consulted. You could take that further if you wish in terms of the appointments. So for me, I think the independent regulator would still have all the functions that it was described, but would still have the oversight by the profession and by the Lord President to make sure they didn't act out with the rule of law or whatever.
I suppose one of the questions, and you talked about a legal standards board, do you see that as the equivalent in England, the legal services board, I think it's called?
This has been a thought that's come to me quite recently, having heard some of the evidence that you've been taking. And, of course, when Chris Kenny set up the legal services board in England, they were very clear that they wanted to be redundant and that they wanted to move to completely independent regulation. As part of my engagement, I went to London and I met with the SRA, the Bar Standards Board, the Law Society and the Bar Association, to get their names right. And of course, that had been portrayed as independent regulation by the SRA and the BSB. But when I spoke to them, they didn't see it as that at all. They were very much of the view that they were controlled by the professional bodies. The chair at that time of the BSB herself was a barrister, and she said, "I'm not even allowed a chequebook. I have to get cheques written by the Bar Association." But the Legal Standards Board was quite clear that their direction of travel was towards properly independent regulation that would remove them and the need for them from the equation. So what I'm suggesting, and it's still in the thinking stage, would be it would be a transitory body that could become the overarching regulator in the longer term as it draws functions to itself from the two professional bodies, but that would have to be done in consultation with them and with the Lord President, obviously.
Okay, so I can understand your point, when you said earlier, you know, the global direction of travel is towards complete independence.
Yep.
How do you... You talk about a transitional relationship, perhaps as a way to solve to deal with the situation we're in at the moment. But I suppose that doesn't address necessarily the contention by the senators and others, actually, that the Court of Session and the Lord President actually do function independently in terms of their regulatory function. Mm-hmm. And I was just wondering if you could tease that out a little bit.
And I do think they could still do that. But instead of it being the two representative membership bodies, it would be the Legal Services Board or whatever you wanted to call it that would still have the overarching responsibility to the Lord President if that was, you know, something that could be agreed on, and that would be for discussion with them. I don't know what the New Zealand position is, other than mm-hmm. that the recommendation has been made. There's been an election there, so we don't know if the new government will prioritise legislating. But I haven't heard from my colleagues in New Zealand that there's any resistance from their judiciary. Now, their model, like the English model, may well be very different from ours historically. But I still believe if the independent regulator was going to compromise the rule of law, we'd be hearing much more objection than we're hearing at the moment.
Mm-hmm. OK, I suppose on a similar point, but just looking at it from the other angle, the proposals in the bill as they stand, and we mm-hmm. expect this to change, is having a role or an accountability or relationship to Scottish ministers. That impinges on the legal profession, on the independence of the legal profession. In your view, with a completely independent body, who would oversee the overseer, mm-hmm. if that makes sense? Because obviously there's not the opportunity for that role, as we've heard, and the government has conceded that having ministerial oversight is problematic for a whole range of reasons. Who would oversee the independent regulator?
Well, and I would be clear, as an individual, taking aside my role here, I'd be really unhappy about government because I think, you know, I might want to sue government one day. Who knows? And if that's the case, I don't want them to be the regulator. So I think there are all sorts of reasons why ministers shouldn't be. At the moment, the model is that the Lord President oversees. But actually, that only means he is consulted and makes decisions. He has no governance responsibility for either of the bodies. Well, actually, I may be wrong there. I am not as familiar with the faculty as I am with the Law Society now. So it is about who would it be accountable to? And that was one of the questions that was asked. And for me, the accountability to Parliament and Audit Scotland is about a financial governance model. It's about the transparency of the finances. And it's about appointing a person to chair and a board that is acceptable both to the public, but also to the judiciary and the legal profession. So I think it's perfectly possible to give the Lord President a responsibility that does make him the ultimate regulator, but in a very hands-off way that keeps him free of potential conflict and of politicisation. I think the one thing that I gathered from my own research and from conversations with the Lord President is nowhere is it very clearly codified what the Lord President's role actually is. And when you ask individual solicitors, they have no idea. So to me, one of the opportunities would be to make that much more explicit and have it agreed and in public domain.
Okay, thank you. And final question, if I may. Just one of the Law Society's contentions, if we went down the route of an independent regulator, it would be considerably more expensive. I just wondered whether that was what your view on that position is.
There is a section in the report, as you'll know, about cost. Partly out of time and partly out of resource, but partly also because the information was so difficult to get to grips with, we couldn't do the kind of detailed analysis I'd like to have done.
Okay.
But if you're a solicitor right now, you have no option but to pay your fee to the Law Society. I think I've said in New Zealand, they're only allowed to take money for regulation. Here, there is no accounting, or there wasn't, it may have changed, that would allow you as a lawyer to say which proportion of your money is spent on regulation and which is spent on the membership and professional body part of it. But the key in the end is we have five organisations currently. The SLCC, the faculty, the chamber, sorry, the faculty, the society, they were commercial attorneys, I believe they've changed their name, and the tribunal. It is not conceivable in my head that to have one organisation doing those things would not be cheaper. And the one thing that we were able to cost was the current cost of the SLCC. And apart from saving on back office functions, the current legislation around complaints makes that complaints handling process much more complex and much more expensive than it needs to be. If we adopted a more modern complaints process, then that should reduce their costs. So the overall levy on the profession should not be more than, and might even be less than, in a streamlined organisation. But I wasn't able to prove that.
Okay. No, I appreciate that. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I'd like to bring in Paul, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to Ms. Robertson. I wonder, I'm just particularly interested in the regularity role for the Lord President that might have been envisaged, just in terms of your review. And, you know, if there was an independent regulator, what role would the Lord President play? Because I think in evidence over the preceding weeks and this morning, we heard the kind of view that the Lord President is an independent regulator. So I wonder if you might just expand on that for committee.
Well, and I do think overall you could argue that he absolutely is. But as I've said earlier, I think it's a much more hands-off role. On a day-to-day basis, the Law Society, and certainly the Law Society, perhaps less so the faculty, because of course the judiciary, I believe, are still members of the faculty. So there is more engagement there. But I do think that to avoid politicisation, to avoid conflict, that should remain a slightly arm's length relationship. But I do think that if you're going to be changing the rules about the training of solicitors, about admissions and the like, the Lord President has to have a role, whether that's a consultative role or a right of veto or whatever, I think could be codified and negotiated. But it was impossible for me in the time available to kind of clarify what the existing functions are and how they were carried out. Because obviously he has a much bigger role than just his role in regulating the profession.
And I wonder, so in the beginning of your remarks, you spoke about this bill, I suppose, being imperfect, to maybe be kind. And so your view would be there could have been a different version of legislation that would have created something that was independent, but with a role for the Lord President, which could have been developed in concert between the parties, essentially.
And I assumed, once I'd published the report and had begun to do some of the engagement I did, that was probably when I started to think about transition. It won't surprise you to know that as time went on, I stopped thinking about it and moved on to other things. But there was no doubt in my mind, just as I worked with them all to write the report in the first place, that were government to adopt my recommendation, it would not be done in a vacuum. It would be done in collaboration with the various bodies and with the Lord President. And the bit I struggle with is that, of course, the SLCC currently is a non-departmental public body answerable to government. And I didn't hear huge amounts of complaint about that at the time. If the new model had been adopted, it would actually have created more space between that part of the operation and government that's there already. But certainly I was surprised to see the scale of the role being put in place for government. And I don't envy your task, delegated powers asking me. I hadn't read them all, but I already knew that government were planning to renegotiate, which makes your next stage of your bill an interesting one, I'm sure.
I wonder if I can just, on that point, I mean, would your view be that compromise is going to be impossible within the current context of the bill and going to be really, really difficult to achieve?
Yes. And I mean, I think consumer bodies, when I was doing my consultation, the CMA weren't even completely explicit, but they became so. I engaged with Citizens Advice. They were on the fence. My understanding now is they believe. The new Consumer Scotland body, Women's Aid, all the organisations that I engaged with on the consumer side are very clear that this compromise does not satisfy their major interests. It satisfies some. I mean, I know Women's Aid will be pleased that they might be able to hire their own lawyers, for example, which was one of the things I was keen to see. But I don't think you can. And it's not a surprise, with all due respect to the faculty and the Law Society, they're never going to be happy if they lose that function. I understand that. But at the same time, personally, and I don't think they believe I believe this, but I do, I think in the long run it would be good for them. I think it would free them up to become professional bodies. And I know that some of the lawyers I spoke to were keen to see the Law Society spend much more time on the representing of Scots law and of contract law and of legal firms beyond Scotland and increasing the kind of visibility and the economic future of the legal profession in Scotland and have that separation. I do believe there are a fair number of lawyers who would welcome it too.
And I wonder if I can. Obviously, this bill is going to be amended. We believe. Government are going to bring amendments. Yeah. We think. You know, we've had that discussion, and we're sort of, that's the known unknown in a sense. Mm-hmm. And we had that discussion with witnesses previously. I wonder, first of all, you know, do you think this bill can be amended to? I mean, you said there that you don't think that the compromise is going to satisfy everyone. Are there other amendments that can be made that would move it into a place where you think we could get more consensus, the first thing? And then the second thing would be, there was a view that the Lord President perhaps didn't feel as consulted in terms of your review as he could have been. So I'm keen to get your view of that. And indeed, they have contributed more, in a sense, to your review that would have maybe got us into a position where the consensus would have existed.
Can I take those in reverse?
Sure, of course.
And I might have to ask you to remind me about the scope of the first one.
Yeah, anyway.
I met with the Lord President twice, once at the very beginning of my review and once at the end, before I started to have the report drafted. With the benefit of hindsight, I could have asked for wider engagement, but my view was that if I met the Lord President, he would speak on behalf of the judiciary. So, yes, I could maybe have done more. And I'm pleased to hear that government are now engaging. In terms of the bill, I'm not a parliamentary draftsperson, so I can't comment on that. I think there are two things. One is, for me, having read the bill, it does not achieve one of the things I was trying to achieve, which is to simplify the process. If anything, it makes it much more complex. I can't get my head round Category 1 and Category 2 regulators and all that stuff. I haven't studied it in the kind of detail I might have. So, yes, I'm sure with consultation could streamline the bill and resolve some of the issues. But you cannot find a compromise between a group of people who are not all consumers, some are lawyers, who believe it should be independent of the profession and the bodies that currently regulate. And you're not going to get a compromise that satisfies both. So it's really about, is Parliament willing to be bold enough to say, actually, we need to find a way that meets the public interest whilst giving as much say to the professions as is possible. And they should have a say, absolutely should have a say and a role. I just don't believe it should be their role any more than I would want the GMC not to be regulating doctors or the like.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Paul. I'd like to move on to Megan, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I must admit, just after the line of questioning from Paul O'Kane, I am concerned about the current status of the bill, and I think you rightly summed it up at the start by saying, you know, I think the bill seems to have upset everyone, and that is certainly true. But I'm just worried because we could end up having to heavily amend and then have to re-scrutinise the amendments that are forthcoming from the Scottish Government, but also then really having to engage with all stakeholders involved. And then that goes beyond the legal side, it also goes into the consumer side, which of course is the whole intent of the bill, is to try and streamline the legal process to make sure that people can access it where possible. But moving that aside, I don't know if you've got any further comments on that part of it, but moving aside and moving on to the concerns relating to the independence between the legal profession, the judiciary and of course the executive. We've had so many concerns and arguments being raised that with the new legislation the Lord President could be drawn into a collaborative administration with Scottish ministers. So I would just like to hear a little bit more about your thoughts on the proposed powers for Scottish ministers as it stands, and if there's any way that we can try and, you know, manoeuvre that to make sure that the judiciary remains completely independent.
To answer your first question first, my biggest concern, and as I say, I'm not a parliamentary draftsman, I helped establish the Parliament and the committee structure, and I've taken an interest in it for 25 years. I know it's a huge ask for a committee to say to the ministers, this bill won't do, go and start again. And in terms of time, we've waited 13 years for alternative business structures. We've waited 5 years since my report was published. To go back to the drawing board is a huge ask. But the bill that established the SLCC, one of the reasons that the SLCC process is so convoluted is because of the amendments that were added at a late stage in the bill. And what came out the end bore very little resemblance, is my understanding, to what went in at the beginning, and had lots of unintended consequences, which lawyers have paid a price for because of the additional complexity, the costs and court of session cases and all of that stuff. So I am concerned about the notion of having to amend a bill so much that by the time you get to the end, it's not ideal. Sorry, I've forgotten the first part, the other part of your question.
Relating to the powers stance of the Scottish Minister.
When I was invited to give evidence to the Delegated Powers Committee, I hadn't looked at the bill at that point. I wasn't sure if I was going to need to. And when I read it, I remembered saying to a former colleague around that table, this will be a very short evidence session. I believe government should have no powers, and therefore should have no delegated powers, is an automatic consequence of that. And that hasn't changed. I really don't think it's in the interest of ministers or in the interest of the profession and the public that they should be involved in this at all. And the notion, I absolutely share, not many things the Law Society and I agreed on, but that was one. But I also share the concerns about the Lord President having to be that close to government. I don't think that's appropriate in terms of the independence of the judiciary, and that's one I would stand very firm on. So, no, I don't. That was the only way I could come to a transition and a compromise, was to say nobody wants government to have those powers, so take them out and put them in an oversight body that could be the next step towards the independent regulator. But I don't know enough to know what the knock-on effects that would be of that would be on the rest of the bill. I'm glad it's you doing that job and not me.
Thank you very much for that. And I'm just wondering, just going back to the first answer that you gave, so do you think where we're sitting now, it's removed far from where you started in terms of your review? And do you think that if there was any advice that you could perhaps give Scottish ministers at this point, would be maybe to relook at the original principles that you outlined?
Yeah. I know that your stage one view is to be on the principle of the bill. And, you know, I, for one, if I were sat around your table, would be saying I don't accept the principle. I spent 18 months making a case for the alternative, and I'm sorry that they felt unable to deliver that.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Megan. I'd like to bring in my colleague Karen, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Esther. Thank you for your evidence thus far. It's been really quite interesting, particularly with the previous session that we had. It's been really helpful to have those side by side, actually. I'd like to ask, really kind of following on from Megan's questions as well, the Scottish Government's proposals to amend the bill to transfer their powers to, or some powers to, the Lord President in specific. What are your views on that?
Until I knew what they were, I couldn't comment, but I can only imagine that it wouldn't be all of them, so it would still leave a role for Scottish Government that I would be uncomfortable with. And as I say, whilst I think the Lord President has a key role to play in all of this, in whatever form that takes, I want him or her, whoever that role is held by, to be independent of government in the best interests of all of us. So I can't see how tweaking and amending that section of the bill could possibly keep that separation of powers between government and the Lord President and judiciary.
So, for example, Lady Dorian stated that the possibility of the Lord President having say over an independent review body, how that would be something that would be problematic. Do you agree that that would be?
It was one of the discussions we had at length around my advisory board table, and there were pretty strong views that had viewed the Lord President shouldn't have any role at all. Mm-hmm. I'm a pragmatist in the end, and I am a defender of the independence of the judiciary and of the rule of law. And if that requires giving the Lord President clear powers, I can live with that. Those powers can just as easily be exercised over an independent regulator as they are at the moment over the faculty and the Law Society, so I don't think that needs to change. But as a member of the public who's now got to grips with this incredibly complicated system, I'd be really keen to see whatever role the Lord President ends up having being clearly codified and articulated so that we could understand what it was. But I do think, and I think it was Chris Kenny made the point, I had a chat with him, that it is that bit about the Lord President should be very careful of being the direct regulator because of the conflict potentially further down the line. So I think being that arm's length regulator as he is at the moment can be exercised over an independent body just the same.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, happy. Fulton, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ms. Roberton. I've got a couple of questions, a bit like my colleague Alan Adam, which is on the substance of the bill as drafted, but I think before I ask those, it would probably be remiss of me not to...
Sorry, I'm struggling to hear a bit.
It would probably be remiss of me not to recognise the concerns that have been raised by yourself and others about the bill and the fact that we will have a decision to make on the general principles of the bill, which looks like it's going to be very difficult, as well as coupled with the fact that there is amendments coming and we don't particularly know when. But taking that aside, because I think you've articulated your concerns around that quite well, I'll move on to questions as the bill is drafted. And my first one is on, a basic question. If you think the bill is drafted in terms of the complaint process, will that be more consumer-friendly than the existing one?
I think there are stages in that process that look better. I don't know all the details of it, and I haven't had any conversations with the SLCC team more recently. I do think that, from my perspective, given what I've looked at across better regulation and consumer principles, the bill should avoid being too prescriptive. I've believed all along that should you have an independent regulator, it should be high-level principles that allows the regulator, in consultation with the professions and the Lord President, to develop procedures that keep up to date with best practice. So I do think there are steps forward, but I couldn't comment in any detail on how much better it would be than the current model. And I'm sure the SLCC will have been pretty clear about that. I mean, I do think under the leadership of Jim Martin and Neil, Jim was on my panel, obviously, they've taken a lot of steps to improve the process as far as was possible within that legislation. But it was still far too complex without question.
OK, thanks very much for that. My second and final question is just to ask for your views on the fact that the bill, as drafted, will remove the right of appeal to the Court of Session. We did hear from the Faculty of Advocates and the Senators, and they expressed us that abolishing the right of appeal is likely to lead to increased delays and expenses in the complaints process. If you get any views on that you'd like to put on the record?
It's a very technical point that goes beyond my detailed expertise, but if I go back to the conversations I was having during my review, I was certainly concerned about the fact that the SLCC had to go very quickly to the court and that was a very costly process and hiring lawyers and hiring advocates and all the rest. But that's a different thing from removing the right of appeal. If I'm taking a complaint to the SLCC or any other body, I want to know that I've ultimately got that right of appeal. But I think it's, if my recollection is correct, it wasn't the right of appeal that was the issue, it was the sudden jump. If that's what's been proposed, I would be concerned, but it's not an area that I'm a particular expert in.
OK, thank you.
OK, happy. OK. Annie, please.
Morning.
Morning,
and thank you, convener. I would just like to get your views on whether the bill as drafted is in line with the Scottish Government's better regulation principles, as was proposed in your report.
No.
No.
It's an easy answer. I went back, Annie, because I wasn't sure, and I've forgotten again, whether the better regulation principles are explicit about the independence point.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the people I consulted as part of the review, and I've just forgotten his name, Russell Griggs, who was the government's advisor on better regulation, and he certainly seemed very clear at that point that independent regulation was the right move, the right direction. So no, I don't think it is in line. I think it's overly complex as well as everything mm-hmm. else.
Yeah. And just one final question from me as well. Just ask you to expand on why you no longer have the view that there is a need for the regulation of the title lawyer.
I haven't said anywhere that I don't believe there is a need. It's the one area where I have wrestled with where I got to at the time, because at the time there was a lot of current noise about mm-hmm. a particular case. And that had generated a view which seemed to be unanimous across the profession and the consumer bodies. But I have reflected a lot, and I'm not sure I would stand by it, but I'm not sure I would abolish it either,
right.
Because I think you don't legislate on the basis of one bad apple. I don't know how prevalent it's been since. As far as I was aware at that time, there had only been one case that everybody knew about. And I do understand there are difficulties. I had the same discussion with the faculty about the advocate title.
Mm-hmm.
But, of course, the point in the end, and I could understand why they wanted it regulated, but they also understood why that's complicated, because it's a word that's used in other contexts. But the bottom line is a consumer doesn't commission an advocate, first of all,
mm-hmm.
and there's not an alternative title. So there's no confusion about the person in the wig in the court for you, whereas between a lawyer and a solicitor mm-hmm. for the public, there is confusion. And it hadn't occurred to me until I got involved. So it's one that I would step back from and allow wiser voices than me, because, as I say, it was a unanimous view, but I suspect it was a knee-jerk against a particular case.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for that. Thank you, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd just like to come back on a few points. I've been listening really carefully. I'd like to generate a little bit more discussion about the consumer's perspective, mm-hmm. Because we have taken lots and lots of evidence from the lawyer's point of view, from every other view. So can you give us a little bit of insight into how the consumer's point of view informed your report at the time,
yep.
Whether your views have developed over that, and whether you think that the consumer is served well by the bill that is presented to us in its current state?
So, I had lots of engagement with consumer bodies. I met with Citizens Advice Scotland, but I also met with some of the managers of individual Citizens Advice services. I met with Women's Aid, I met with, not with Consumer Scotland, of course, because it didn't exist at that point. And there was a general view that the current model wasn't designed to meet the needs of consumers, and particularly not those in the most need. There was a whole conversation, and I had been there, and I think I use the words in here, nobody consults a lawyer other than in times of stress. Not always distress, although it can be that, but stress, because we all know, even if it's buying a house, that's a stressful thing. And that power imbalance was there. And the view around the tables of all the consumer groups that I met with was that that power imbalance wasn't helped by the fact that the profession were regulating themselves. One of the clear things that I did come up with, which I think I know that the Women's Aid people are happy about, was this notion of why couldn't Citizens Advice or Women's Aid or whoever employ their own lawyers? And I think that there are a range of ways that my report addressed that. I'm not sure if the bill does in terms of entity regulation and the like. And that can all be very proportionate. You don't apply the same kind of entity regulation to Women's Aid as you would to Vincent Mason's or Harper McLeod. So I think that was the general view, was that they would have much more confidence in a situation. A very specific example from Women's Aid was about the fact that when a woman came to them for advice, they would look for a lawyer that had a background in that sector. And the Law Society offered, I'm not sure if they call it an accreditation scheme, but if you went on the Law Society's website, my understanding was there would be a group of lawyers who claimed to be specialists in domestic abuse cases. But the view was they had not been involved in any discussions about that, and that their experience of dealing with lawyers under that category was that they hadn't had any special training, they didn't have accreditation, and not necessarily even a lot of experience in that field. And there were some real horror stories about women being very badly let down by their legal advisers. I'm sure it's not common across the board, but there were enough awful stories. I met some women, directly involved, not just the workers. So there was a general view that consumer principles, better regulation principles, perception, power imbalance, all of those things. I heard no voices at all opposed to the notion of independent regulation and being taken out of the hands of the Law Society.
That's interesting. We've also heard this morning about the case where a citizen could want to sue the government. However, what about the consumer, the person on the street that maybe wants to sue the lawyer because they haven't received a good service? And what I have heard anecdotally, albeit, but also through constituency, people know that we're dealing with this, they're coming, that their experiences, I've heard some that have not had good experiences, that they feel that they're up against a whole system, that system's going to look after itself. Did you sort of like speak to individuals or did you look at casework like that? Could you give us an example of that?
It's a really good point. And for those of you that know my background, you'll know that I've chaired health boards. And of course, we have the same sort of debate in the health service about the public and their complaints. And what I found in the legal side was much the same as in the health service. Most people don't want to sue. They want satisfaction. They want speedy resolution. They want an apology or whatever. And in some points, yes, compensation. If it's an illegal situation, there will potentially be a financial loss in a way there isn't in the health service. So for me, I think it was that absolute view. And one of the things we looked at in quite a lot of detail, using the experience we had around the table and elsewhere in complaints handling, was that law firms themselves didn't all have particularly effective complaints handling procedures. And if you're in a public body, you can't go to the ombudsman unless you can demonstrate you've been through that process. And one of my recommendations was that an independent regulator shouldn't take a punitive approach, but should take a quality improvement approach to work with law firms to help them develop appropriate processes. And part of the argument against it is lawyers themselves are under a huge amount of pressure in many cases. And if the complaints against them might have a conduct element that might end up in the society prosecuting them, sometimes the head in the sand is the easiest thing to deal with because it's all too much. So my view was that you take a much more positive, much more supportive model that says you help firms develop proper complaints procedures that mean fewer complaints ever come to the regulator, and that one option would be available to say that if you have a persistent offender, if you like, who doesn't respond to the positive approach, then you can fine. And at the moment, the SLCC has no opportunity to address a firm that might be a multiple offender, because that is not allowed in the legislation. But a regulator that had oversight of the whole process would not just know this is a firm that's not handling its complaints well, they might also know it was a firm that was in financial difficulty or whatever, and could take a kind of whole systems approach to that. So my view is, you know, it's not punitive, it's not about encouraging people to sue, but my goodness, I wouldn't want to be somebody trying to sue a law firm, because that would be a very expensive process apart from anything else. So, you know, take all the steps you can to avoid that ever reaching that stage would be my view.
Thank you very much for that. We have actually come to the end of our session, but I did want to give you an opportunity. Was there anything that we haven't covered that you would like to bring to our attention? This is your time.
No, I don't think so. No doubt I'll be halfway down the stairs and I'll remember something.
Yes,
no, I think your question is very fair, and I've had an opportunity to say what I needed to say. So thank you very much, and I wish you every success with the task ahead of you. I will be watching with some interest.
Thank you once again for your evidence. So that concludes our business in public this morning. We will now move into private session to consider the remaining item on our agenda. Thank you.